Okay. I am Yogendra Deva and I welcome you to this edition of Open Houses. This is the 8th and the topic and the speaker don't need any introduction, but definitely I will hand over the session to Dr. Dhawan. But before I do that, just a couple of things I would like to share with you. First thing that as always, this is a strictly 1 hour finished topic webinar, and it is you know that it is driven by you. I mean, you give us the topics and we serve you on those things. Then as soon as the presentation is start by our speaker, you can start raising the queries on the chat box, which we'll be taking up after the presentation is over. And finally, I want to say goodbye to all of you as the host of this program, because from the next program you will see a new face as the host, and I can assure you the face will be much better than mine. So look forward to a new host in the next program. And because the topic is such that we expect lot of activity on that, lot of queries on that, so I will not take any more time, and I hand over the session to Dr. Dhawan for giving the introduction. And Dhawan sahab, aapka face ka nazar nahi aa raha hai, thoda sa apna screen ko par kar
diye. It's okay now.
Yeah, the screen ka face pura, acha maybe yes, face cut raha hai.
Okay, now it's okay. Thank you very much, Deva sahab. I welcome Shri S.L. Kapil to DDAG's Open House platform. I am really very happy to introduce Shri Kapil, as I have a very special bond with him. Firstly, because we share the same alma mater, University of Roorkee, now IIT Roorkee. Mr. Kapil is pass out of 1984. He is M.Tech in Applied Geophysics. Secondly, we worked together for more than 3 decades in NHPC. Shri Kapil had started his career as a geophysicist with Punjab State Tubal Corporation, and later in 1987 he joined NHPC. He is one of the leading engineering geophysicists in our country who had conducted geophysical surveys for more than 100 hydropower projects in India, Nepal, Bhutan and Myanmar. Shri Kapil had introduced several new techniques in NHPC like seismic tomography, resistivity imaging, MASW, blast vibration monitoring and tunnel seismic prediction systems. These techniques have helped NHPC in minimizing geological problems and uncertainties at their construction projects to a very large extent. With his efforts, today we have a very strong team of geophysicists in NHPC, which is capable of carrying out any kind of geophysical investigations. I mean, it is state of the art, almost at par with any international standards. He had established a real-time seismic data center at NHPC Faridabad for online monitoring of power stations and quick assessment of earthquake events around our projects. NHPC is the only power utility, and I'm very happy to share with you that NHPC is the only power utility having such in-house real-time seismic monitoring facility. Mr. Pandey would be very much happy to know this, because he is a person who takes a lot of interest in seismology, and he himself is a very renowned seismologist. Due to his commitment in the work and due to his innovative ideas in NHPC, in 2016, Mr. Kapil was awarded an exemplary commitment award for his innovative work. Presently, he is executive director, Geotech and Project Investigation Division, NHPC. He is leading a strong team of more than 100 geologists and geophysicists with overall responsibility of complete survey, investigation, and construction geological supervision of NHPC projects. In addition to his official portfolio, he is Secretary of ISAG and Vice President of ISRM India. He is also a member of several BIS committees. Once again, I welcome Shri Kapil and invite him to take over the mic. Mr. Kapil, please.
And now everybody is requested to mute the mic. Video is okay, but mic should be muted.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for introducing me. And actually, whatever I would like to share this, that whatever we have done in NHPC and whatever we are doing, the credit goes to our senior colleague like Dr. Gopal Dhawan, and another was he was a very close to our heart, Bandhupadhyay sahab. So, and because of the facility, because of the always motivation from the management also, we could develop such a good work facility in NHPC, and we are proud of that. Now, I think we can start the straightway lecture, sir.
Yes.
So I would like to open my screen. Sir, are you able to see my screen?
Yes.
Yes, Kapil, we can see.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. So today the topic is the application of new age investigation techniques for construction of long tunnels in the Himalaya. So we will be discussing about the tunnel investigation as well as some of the works which we can use, which we can optimize through geophysical techniques. I will be covering the introduction, tunneling in Himalayas, and major geological problems in Himalayan region. Are these actual geological issues? Role of engineering geology, modern geological technology, and what are the new emerging geophysical technologies? So now if you see, this is the Himalaya, and you can see the place of the Himalaya in the world. And most of our projects, hydro projects, they are located in Himalayas. And as all of us know, that Himalayan geology is a very challenging. And here, because of the specific issues like Indian plate, it is meeting with the Eurasian plate. And due to this, lot of earthquakes are being generated in this region, and because of these earthquakes, lot of faulting and tectonic activities are there, and these things always created problems in the rock mass characteristics. And whenever we are working within these rock mass, so we are facing serious geological challenges. And these are some of the projects where we have faced a lot of problems, like in Dulasti, water flow, shearing, busting, Kishanganga also some squeezing zones, Uri also squeezing zone. And in Salal, we got some foundation problem, Thin Dam, Bhakra also, Chamera One, Tapovan, Vishnu Ghat, the Maneri Bhali, Loktak, Subhansri, and Nathpa Jagri, Parvati Two. We have got serious problems of the rock busting, shear zones, and water ingress, and we are struggling with this project still now. So most underground projects which are executed under variable geological conditions and more often in complex geological conditions supplemented by extreme hydrological conditions. So we have some shear zones, fault zones, and these are sometimes associated with the lot of water ingress, and this creates very, very serious problem for our projects. Tunneling in Himalaya is a very challenging activity, and most of the India's hydropower projects have faced and are facing time and cost overrun due to tunneling related issues. In most of the projects, if we see, due to problem, although we are able to construct powerhouses and dams, but tunneling becomes a very, very critical issue. And due to the tunneling problems, our projects are delayed and we are seriously facing time and cost overruns. This is a list of some of the projects where we have this tunneling. And if you see this, in most of the projects, large tunnelings are associated. In Parvati 2, we have around 32 kilometer tunneling. Kishan Ganga also, we had 23 kilometer. Chamera project also, it was around 16, and Tista 5 also 17 kilometers. So almost, and in most of these projects, we always faced very, very big problems. Although fortunately in some of the projects like Kishan Ganga, we could successfully utilize TBM and we could almost complete the tunneling work without any delay. The main problems in our projects are presence of paleo and buried channels, dam foundation problems, also some slope, this instability of cut slopes, instability of powerhouse cut slopes, cavity chimney formation, flowing ground conditions in tunnel, water ingress. Sometimes we also faced some daylighting of tunnel in low cover zones, and these are some of the problems which we just can see, which we have faced. Like in Tista 5, we got some shear zone in dam foundation, and this surge shaft also collapsed due to this poor rock mass conditions. In Nemo Basgo also, and this is from the Subansiri, where we got a serious problem of the slope failure. And this is from the, this you can see from the Parvati 2 project and Dulasti projects, and these two projects suffered massively because of the issues in the tunneling. And most, many of who are attending this, they already know about the problems which we still are facing, particularly in Parvati 2 project. So like most of the times, these geological issues, these are termed at that some geological surprises are there. But unfortunately, because of the some inadequacy in the investigation, generally the unexpected geological features encountered during construction, which were not anticipated at the time of investigations, are generally termed as geological surprise. But because like all we see that in Himalayas, we get very, very low chance of the investigation of the tunneling works. And you cannot say that always these are all geological surprises. These are some geological uncertainties and which you have to encounter because of the limitations of our investigations technology, and plus the remoteness of the projects and the remoteness of the our HRTs like this. So it may be prudent to use the term geological risk or geological problem, which are more quantifiable rather than geological surprises. So what are the reasons for geological problems variations? So So generally we have the inadequate geological investigations, poor anticipation of the nature and magnitude of the problem, poor judgment of rock conditions ahead of the tunnel, lack of coordination between geologists and engineers resulting in improper design and construction methodology. So for proper management of the proper construction of a project, what we need? We need that we should collect the maximum data for better geological and geotechnical appraisal and to select the best layout of the civil structures, to adopt measures to reduce impact of geological surprises, if any. And these can only be tackled if we do comprehensive investigations. So what we do that because of the delay, in because of the limited time, we are not in a position to have the detailed investigations, and because of the limit time and pressure from the management also for submission of the DPRs, so very sometimes limited investigation is done. So and then during construction we face serious problems. So the construction of large civil engineering structures without adequate geological investigations can be compared a surgeon who operated without proper diagnosis or a lawyer who pleaded without thorough discussion with the client. So engineering geologist has a pivotal role right from inception to commissioning and post commissioning stage of the projects. Now if you see overall our hydropower projects, so what is the level of uncertainties in our structures? So in case of dam, like most of the times we are very very thoroughly we investigate our dams, and so here the level of geological uncertainties is comparatively low. Then now if you go for the surface powerhouse, so slightly increase, and then if you go for subsurface cavern also, then again our uncertainties increases, shaft also, and tunneling. In case of tunneling, we have the most very high level of geological uncertainties, and we have a very big limitation also for tunnel investigations. And because of all these issues, we generally struggle during construction, particularly for the tunnels. These are the role of engineering geology we can define in different stages of hydropower projects, like in pre-feasibility stage, feasibility, DPR, construction stage, and post-construction and O&M stage. So generally we say that how much investigations we should carry out. We sometimes try to correlate it with the project cost. And in case of general international projects, it is a figure that 5 to 6% of the project cost is spent during construction, and time also given proper time. But in India, it is almost 2% and below for the investigation allocation, and time also we have very very limited time. So inadequate investigation leads to a very very disastrous situation and for the construction of the project. So what we should do that although it is related to the cost, we should also try to do that what type of investigation, and we should try to cover the area. Like if you have a HRD, so we should try to adopt such technology which can cover almost the entire area. What is the investigation protocol we are following? We are doing this topographical survey, remote sensing, geological mapping, some direct method we are doing drilling, drifting, trenching and pitting, and with indirect method geophysical investigations we are doing seismic resistivity, seismic tomography we can do, and this time domain electromagnetic also. Then we are also doing this seismological studies. So now how we are doing this investigation for particularly for the tunnels. So this is a map I have taken from the Gauriganga project, Gauriganga 3rd A. And if you see, this color is associated with the slope wash material. This is my tunnel. This is a plan of my tunnel alignment. And if you see that almost entire area, very few, you can say less than 5 to 10% area is just you have some outcrops, and other area is just covered with the slope wash material. Rock exposure is not also available. And based on such information, and if you do not do any other investigations, then when we try to develop the cross section along this tunnel, so it leads to very, very large uncertainties. And sometimes, like if we have some drill holes, like you have a 2 drill holes here. So suppose I have a tunnel which is has a length of around 10 kilometer, and even if I try to do some drill hole also, a drill hole has, like I try to do a 76 mm dia drill hole, even if I try to do 3-4 holes, so this 76 mm, it will represent almost these three to four drill holes. If you combine, so it will represent only a 0.001% of the entire 10 kilometer. So this is also a very, very limited information. So what we need, that we should try to do some other techniques so that we can cover those areas. Like suppose if I try to make some geophysical investigations along these lines, so at least it will give you some idea what is below this slope wash material, and we can have some assessment of a better assessment of the geological conditions. So this generally we prepare on the basis of whatever is visible, with very limited information. This is from the Kishanganga project, and you can see that this was the initially given geological section, and this section we have obtained after excavation. This is also another part of this. Although sometimes we say that whatever rock class we have predicted, almost sometimes the percentage wise it matches. But like our problem where lies? Our problem lies in class 4 or class 5 rock. Even 1% class 5 is more coming, then this is completely ruin your project. So just in case of Kishanganga, this class 3 rock, this was actually encountered, this was predicted 65%, and this is 58%. But if you see this class 5, so initially this class 5, it was given 1.94%, but actually it is 3.28%. So the variation in class 4 and class 5, it directly has a big correlation with the problem you encounter. You are not having a problem with class 3 or class 2. So there, if you have some changes in class 3, class 2, that is not making much difference. But the changes in class 4 and 5, it makes huge difference. Even a 10 meter zone, 10, 20 meter zone, it can ruin a whole, the complete project. This is from another project which we will be just executing, this Tista 6 project. This we have taken through NCLT. And in this case also, if you see, this is the section based on prepared based on the limited information And here you see when they were doing some tunneling in this, so in this tunnel it was just daylighted, and serious problem was encountered during construction. This is the length which this tunnel has been constructed, and balance has to be constructed by NHPC. This is from the Parvati 2 project, and there also we are facing very serious problems because of the rock busting and water ingress. So what are the tools which are available to us, and what tools we can utilize? These tools cannot fully eliminate the problems which we are encountering in our projects, but definitely these tools can help us a lot. Like now, if we think about the medical science, in medical science around 2020, 22, 25 years back, there was a direct invasion system was there, that if you had to get an operation, then complete cut was to be done, and it creates downtime was also very long. But now they have improved it, and now like we have MRI, we have CAT scanning, many other tools, and definitely these tools have helped medical science a lot. And similar type of tools now we are available to us also, and these can minimize some of the geological risks which we are already encountering. Suppose this is my HRT here, and now if you see complete, it is covered by the vegetation, and rock exposure is not there, and very limited information will be there, and based on that we try to develop the map of the section of the tunnel. So it is not that we are lagging in the proper geological mapping, but it is the limitation of the geological mapping that which we can slightly make much better with the help of this geophysical techniques. So in case of simple, if you see what are the tools available to us in geophysical exploration. So in geophysical exploration, if you see, the main system is that we have the whatever subsurface is there, so you can have the resistivity of the rock mass, seismic velocity, magnetic susceptibility, density, radioactivity. These are very small, these are some of the few properties of the material which we can measure. And because these properties have direct influence with the geological conditions, geological assessment, like if we talk about the resistivity, so resistivity of a strong rock, it will be very high, and resistivity of a shear zone, it will be very low. So we will have a big contrast, and if we have such, so it can definitely help us that this is the area where I can expect the if you have the low resistivity zone, then it can indicate that I am going to get some problem in this area. Similarly, seismic velocity are also like that only. High velocity means high, that the structure is very strong, and if you have the low velocity, the structure is comparatively weak. Subsurface conditions and geological conditions, geological characteristic of the rock mass is completely weak. So what has changed the scenario? Although all of us, we know that some of the earlier also we were doing the geophysical surveys, particularly for engineering geophysics. The one of the limitation in engineering geophysics that we have very limited people Even if you talk about our country, you will have very, very limited people, very, very limited resources, very, very limited instruments. And due to this, generally we think like most of the people, we think that we have some of the people, they have the experience that yes, we have done the resistivity survey and it has not yielded the good results. We have done the seismic survey, it has not given the correct results. Because we don't know who is doing the survey, what type of instruments are there. So now, just 3 decades back, due to lack of technological advancement in hardware and software, the geophysical instruments and technology were in development stage and relied on basic theories of homogeneous isotropic and subhorizontal layered earth. Actually, these limitations, these were the basic based on the basic theories. But now, because like in a case of engineering, now we have the finite element analysis. So similar things have been introduced in the geophysical technology also, that we have introduced this finite element. So in case of finite element, so I now need not to have the layers are subhorizontal, these has the isotropic and homogeneous. So even very small cell, we can optimize. So this has given us and we have now much more interpretation capabilities, and now you can even collect data in very undulating areas, which was not possible earlier. And you can generate 2D, 3D pictures. In tunnels also, like now this tunnel seismic prediction has been introduced, and it can also be helpful. These are some of the techniques like resistivity imaging, seismic tomography, tunnel seismic prediction, beam, MSW, GPR, and electromagnetic geophysical techniques. So we will take some of the case studies where we have done this resistivity imaging and how we have utilized this technology in a much better way. So how this technology was developed? Basically, this two Schlumberger brothers were there, and they were mining engineers, and they thought that the electrical properties of different rocks had different resistivity, and based on that, this electrical property, they tried to use this property for the mining exploration. And what they did, they carried the first test in a bathtub, and they filled the various rocks for their experiment in a bathtub, and then they measured the resistivity with their potential. This they have carried out around this 1919, and even they signed an agreement with their father, in which their father would support their scientific research. Means that they have made a contract, they have taken money from their father, and just to support their scientific activity. And because of this, a very big development was there. This Schlumberger protocol was developed based on this, and now we are using it for the last 100 years almost. This technique is being used now. Lot of development has been taken in this, and this has been improvised a lot because of the development in the software and hardware. So, and still the principle remains the same, that we need 4 electrodes to measure the resistivity. It is very simple. Like, why we are preferring this resistivity? You don't need any license for the blasting. Just it can be done on any type of ground, even in a very, very crowded area also, sometimes it can be used. And you can just have to put some electrodes on the ground surface, and the data is collected. Now, if you see that how the resistivity is varying for different rocks. So like if you have granite, diorite, andesite, basalt. So you have, this is the range of the resistivity. And now you see here, this is the problem actually many of us face, that the resistivity of different rocks, these are overlapping. So based on simple resistivity, you cannot say that it is granite, it is a diorite, it is a basalt. So you have to apply your judicious thinking. You have to apply the area, what are the geological conditions you accept in the area. So these are the basic things. Like if you have this clay here, in this clay you have 1 to 100 ohm meter resistivity. So that's why it is a very, very powerful tool for assessment of the shear zone in a rock, because there you will have a good contrast, and that is what we are looking for. So what we can do with the resistivity imaging, that you can do the bedrock depth estimation, you can detect the cavity, groundwater assessment, and many other things can also be done. This is the basic principle. Now in resistivity imaging, you have a system which is we call roll along. Previously it was in the seismic system, and you can connect so many profiles continuously to cover the complete area in a continuous manner. Now the same technology is available, and simply if you say here, this is the data we collect from the equipment. And then large number of, like you have a main system and around 64 electrodes we place on the ground, and then we continuously go on collecting the data, and then you have the roll along system, and the complete profile of the area can be generated. So just to check whether the imaging it produces the results which we expect, what we did, this is from a from the Mangdechu project. Actually we carried lot of geological investigation for Mangdechu project. So what we did actually, this is a road alignment, and below the road there was a drift for powerhouse, and it was around 12 meters. So what we did, we laid a profile on the road side, and we tried whether it is capable of detecting the drift. And you see, this is beautifully it has created the drift. So this generated confidence in us that it is capable of generating the images which we are looking for. Similarly,
Kapil sir, थोड़ा तेज चलना पड़ेगा.
जी चल रहा हूँ सर, मैं चल रहा हूँ.
15 मिनट आपके पास और, ठीक है?
जी जी.
Only 15 minutes are with you.
जी. Okay. So this is again, you can see here, you can detect the cavities. And the another case study which I will share with you, it is from the project in Kerala. And in this project, the HRT of the project, it was investigated thoroughly, and around 40 drill holes were made. The complete investigation was done, and after doing around 60% tunneling, the tunnel was collapsed and a chimney was formed, and the work was stopped. Basically they were stuck up there for 2 years. Then they contacted us, and then we suggested that resistivity imaging can help in this. And if you see, lot of difficulties were there, because it was the tunnel was going below a national highway, and you cannot stop the national highway. So we made very elaborate arrangement for this, and then we took this measurement. Now if you see here, this is the location where the tunnel was collapsed here, and based on the geological mapping section, based on the drilling, because it was a very, very nearby drilling was also there. So a very good rock mass was indicated, fresh pegmatite rock was there, but Unfortunately, this tunnel was collapsed. Similarly, a drift was also there, and again the chimney was formed. So we carried out imaging along the line, and if you see, this is the huge data which we have collected, large data, more than 3,200 data points were collected, covering the 2.9 kilometer length. And now if you see here, this is the location of the tunnel collapse here, and we could map the complete area where we expect a large weak zone, shear zone, you can say it was water ingress. And rest of the tunnel, it was very good. Rock mass was there only in this area. So such type of problems, even if you do drilling, you are not able to map this, because you cannot do this. Length is almost around 150 to 200 meters. So this can help you a lot. And based on our assessment, then we prepared this geological section, and two zones were indicated where we had a problem, but rest of the tunneling work was, and we could penetrate up to a depth of around 200 meter. Similarly, in Vishnugad Pipalkoti, this project is being executed, and it is planned a TBM will be there. And they have a very long, 630 meter long TBM launch at it. Initially, as per the assessment, it was thought that around 50 to 60 meter rock will be met in the edit, but unfortunately this could not be met. And then they contacted us. Initially they told us that you do TSP, but we suggested that imaging will be helpful, and then we carried out imaging. And based on the imaging, now if you see here, so this is the profile of the rock profile, if you see here. And then we suggested, we gave them report in August 2019, and we suggested that you carry out a drill hole further. So they have drilled a hole also, and it was completed in December 2019. So based on our assessment, it was now that up to 200 meter rock is not expected to be present. So this was the, then based on this tenor, again we prepared this section. Similarly, in Bhutan also this was carried out very seriously. So in seismic also similar, we have done a lot of works for the seismic also, and it can help you a lot in measurement of. So one of the very, very important application we have done in Pakaldul project. In Pakaldul project, actually, if you see, this is the initial alignment of the divergent tunnel. And we did this survey just because of the curiosity, because we went there for some other work. But I saw that there are some issues, and it was also suggested by our people also. So then we carried out. Initially, based on the drill hole, the depth of bedrock was assessed around 15 meter. But when we carried out this survey, it was around 40 meter in this area. And then we suggested them that it is a problem, and again later a drill hole again was done. And then this is the original divergent tunnel, and based on this the tunnel, these were the data. And then this was the alignment. Now this was, so because of this problem, the tunneling for this divergent tunnel, it was, could not be started from the intake side, and it was started from the outlet side, and then is shifted, and now this has been completed without any issue. Similar case studies we have for the this Parvati 2 project also. There was a Hurla Nala approach tunnel, and in this tunnel also initially it was not thought that we can have the will be in a problem, but we carried out this on a very very tough conditions this survey, and it was suggested that initially 50 meter will not be in a rock, we will not get rock, and now this tunnel has been excavated and we could not get the rock in this area. Similar, we have carried out for this huge survey, lot of this seismic reflection survey was done in and in Tamanti project Myanmar, and we could generate. So this is just a simple showing that we can generate a 3D picture of the complete area. So now the seismic tomography is a very wonderful tool, and it is like a CAT scanning which we are using in medical science. So and similar theory is based, similar theory we are utilizing for this. So now this is the simple picture here, that if you have a seismic reflection, you will not have the detailed resolution, will be very very low, but in case of tomography you will have a detailed resolution, and which is very very helpful. So how this can be done for in drill holes, tunnel, shaft like that, and based on the inversion you can generate a picture of the scanned area. This is one of the case study, it was done by this four Olympic cavern hall for this geovic Olympic cavern hall in Norway. And what they have done, they wanted to have this Olympic hall, so what, just to place it in a precise way, they have done one drill hole and then another surface, and this area was scanned based on this. Was done earlier even in 1994, now we have much better technology. And if you see, this is the location of the cavern, and there where we had a low velocity zone, they just removed that area. So we have utilized the seismic tomography in a very very successful manner in Parvati 2 project. Parvati 2 project, everybody knows that we had a very huge problem of silt, and our TBM almost in 2006 there was a huge problem, silt came and the TBM was stuck up, and it was just started in October 2015. So almost we lost around 9 years in this. So what was the basic problem at that? This is the TBM here, and based on the lot of drilling works, lot of this mapping of that area, that a fault was apprehended ahead of the TBM phase, and just to grout this area, a side tunnel was made, and through this side tunnel grouting was done. This grouting continued almost to 1.5 years, and after this extensive grouting, some cores were extracted from this. And if you see, after grouting also, this was the condition of the core, and again it was thought that the area is not fully grouted and it is very difficult to move ahead. Even some of the consultants, they suggested that it is very difficult, we cannot take TBM directly through this area, and they suggested that this tunnel should be extended another 45 meter, and then you come to this main tunnel and excavate it through DBM and then walk over the TBM. So there we conducted this seismic tomography. Initially we made angular drill holes in the starting and in the end. So this was the angular drill hole, this is the tunnel dia, you can tunnel section you can see here also. And now we did this tomography here. And the serious problem in this was that in tomography you need you have hydrophone sensors, and these work in the water field area. So we made a very very special arrangement there locally. What we did in drill holes, we inserted, this was our sensor pipe, we inserted another pipe for checking the water level, and then we connected a small pump in this, and then we filled this. So it was a very, very tough condition, but fortunately we could make the measurements. And finally, if you see here, this is the data which we utilized for the calibration, and this is the final picture you can see here. The fault zone, actually we could see here, this is my the tunnel section, and if you see here, this is showing that this is not crossing this area, and even in invert also it has indicated a very strong rock mass. So then we suggested that we can move the TBM directly and do not have much challenge as we had thought earlier. In the end part also, we had very good rock mass. And there was a cavity which we could map. It was around 6-7 meter above the crown. And then successfully, this TBM was moved. And now we have excavated almost 2 kilometers from that location. Similarly, TSP, tunnel seismic prediction, is also a wonderful technique. And this we are utilizing successfully in our project. It is capable of prediction up to a range of 100 to 200 meters, depending on the rock mass condition. This we successfully utilized in Parvati 2. In Parvati 2 project, actually, after this big problem which we encountered, further studies were done, and based on some remote sensing studies, our in-house team also did some remote sensing study, and we took the help from the IIRST Dehradun also, and these main zones were predicted. This Kapil was sir, around 83. Sir.
The Kapil sir, you will have to wrap up in next 4 minutes, please.
Okay. So these zones actually, these zones we successfully, with the help of this TSP, we negated all these zones, and fortunately these zones were did not come, and we crossed the TBM without much problem in this area. These are the results which we have during this all. So what we did, whenever we expected that a zone is there, so almost 30 to 40 meter ahead of the zone, we conducted this TSP survey, and then we gave the assessment to the site. And in 4 zones, we clearly negated that we are expecting a very good rock mass without any problem. And fortunately, we could get the similar rock mass conditions. Another thing is that beam, most of the people know that bore tunneling electrical head monitoring is also a new technology. And this also works on the electrical properties, like we have resistivity. So this is also working on the same principle. This technology, you can have the based on the focused electrode, focused current method, and it give you the assessment ahead. If you have say 7 meter dia of the tunnel, so you can expect a length of around 20 meter. But this is not yet commercialized, and they are giving it on rent, and they are the main company. They are they give this system on rent. But some of the limitations, like you have a very, very small length of the prediction, and side areas are also not in quality of the side areas in the tunnel are not indicated. So this technology still has some limitations, but the beauty of this technology is that you don't need to make any probe holes, and just you collect the data ahead of the tunnel, and if it is indicating, it will indicate you, like suppose it is showing you that this is an area where you have a weak rock. So accordingly, you can plan, you can do grouting in this, all those things can be done. And the company claim that more than 80 projects they have utilized it. And all, we do not have much experience about this, but it is certainly has ease of operation in comparison to other. You don't need to do any drill holes, just you have to put the electrode on the cutter head of the TBM and you can collect the data. Similarly, this is now a very, very wonderful technology, time domain electromagnetic method. So like in Himalayas, we have very big limitation. You cannot go into that area because of the remoteness. So some helicopter-borne electromagnetic survey can be done. And now the technology is available that you can go up to a depth of say 500 to 800 meter. And recently this survey has been carried out for this Manali to Leh, the proposed railway line, because there will be a lot of tunneling works in that area. And so through helicopter, just you have to lay some sensors and you can cover the area. And they claim this is also again electromagnetic, but it is also give you the properties of the rock mass in terms of the resistivity. So like such type of picture you can generate it. Even GPR also, now people are claiming that it can give up to a depth of around 250 meter. And some of the picture, actually we have come across a company, TerraVision, and they claim that they can give up to a depth of 250 meter, although still we have not used it, but they are claiming that they have developed a very, very high energy sensor and it can penetrate up to a depth of 200, more than 200 meter. So this audiomagnetic telluric method is also similar to electromagnetic. And this is from a picture from the China, and they have again gone up to a depth of 400 meter, and you can have, so based on this they could locate some fault and like some weak zones here, and the whole area can be mapped. So time domain electromagnetic is a very, very new emerging technology, and I think it can be helpful. It can be utilized for assessment of rock mass conditions in the areas where we have difficulty, in assessing the area, even remoteness, and we should try. So we have discussed now, because of the development in the hardware and software technology, the results are better. But the limitation is that still in our country, we have very, very limited people who do not have much experience. And that's why sometimes we think that these techniques are not useful. But I think we should try to use this, because the beauty of those technology, like in case of tunnel, I told, suppose if we make two or three drill holes, it will give you the just 0.001% of a tunnel. But if you...
Sir, the time is almost up.
Sir. But in case of this, because geophysical technology, you can cover the complete area. So even if we do lot of extensive drilling also, even in that case also, some area will remain which can give you the big problem. So we should try to map the complete area as much as possible. And I would like to close. There is a very big say by this Joe Biden, who will be the now next president of USA. He say, never say never. So that's why for this technology also, we should try to use if it is possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Kapil. It was really a very nice and very informative presentation as usual from you. And Mr. Kapil has covered almost all the full gamut of geophysical techniques which can be useful during construction of projects, and particularly resolving crucial issues. And Mr. Kapil himself has done it many a times in NHPC. He was very innovative whenever we were facing any problem. And although we were not having equipment, initially I remember that when we used seismic tomography. We did not have the complete equipment, but Mr. Kapil did something, some innovation, some jugaad, and he did tomography across the river, and the results were very useful. Time is short, so we will not be in a position to take up questions in this session. I will request all the participants and invitees to send questions through emails. We will forward to Mr. Kapil, and we will share the answers with you. And Mr. Kapil, today you have covered beautifully the application of geophysical techniques for construction projects. But I would love to hear from you sometimes that how we can supplement the geological data during investigations, because a lot of people are doing good work in AEM surveys, but results are yet to be verified. And in investigations, it's a big challenge in case we can improve upon our investigation, level of investigation data. I think we will do a good service to the nation. Well, thank you very much. And with these words, I hand over to Mr. Deva.
So thank you very much, Dr. Dhawan. Thank you very much, Kapil Saab. A lovely lecture from you, as usual, as Dhawan Saab said. And now the time is over. So I think we will have to say goodbye. And we will meet you next month for the next open house, that is edition 9. And till then, enjoy the festive season, enjoy Diwali, and wait for us to return. Thank you very much.